Item on the agenda is consideration of whether taking items 5 and 6 in private. Item 5 is consideration of evidence we will hear today as part of our inquiry into Scotland's electricity infrastructure. Item 6 is to consider correspondence relating to the appointment of the Board of Environmental Standards Scotland. Do we agree to take those items in private? We are agreed, so they will be taken in private. The next item on our agenda is an evidence session as part of our inquiry into Scotland's electricity infrastructure, inhibitor or enabler of our energy ambitions. This is a new inquiry, the aim of which is to scrutinise what electricity infrastructure will be needed to realise the ambitions set out in the Scottish Government's new draft energy strategy and just transition plan. This will be a short inquiry leading to a report to the Scottish Government as it finalises its strategy. Today we'll hold the first evidence session for the inquiry, with two panels comprising a wider range of interest in energy. And I'm pleased to welcome Stuart Hazeldine, Professor of Carbon Capture and Storage, the University of Edinburgh. Claire Lavelle, the Director of Energy and Advisory Leader North of Arup. Emily Rice, Scotland's Policy Analyst for Solar Energy UK, and Tom Quinn, the Head of Analyst Insights Offshore Renewable Energy Catapult. Thank you for accepting our invitation to be here today. And we have a series of questions which we will move straight on to. But before we do, I'd like to remind members and people listening that as a farmer and a landowner, I have electricity transmission lines across my farm, both in the form of 11 kV, which are the small ones, 33 kV, which are the bigger ones, which are ring mains, and I'm in negotiation with a 132 kV power line to go through the farm. All of them will generate some income at some stage for me, so I want there to be no doubt that I have some interest, and I will make that declaration as and when it's appropriate. I don't believe it prevents me from doing my job as convener today. So the first questions today are going to come from Liam Kerr. Liam.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'll throw this question initially to Tom Quinn, if I may. And it's about what we might call baseload and non-intermittent generation. We know that in Scotland, nuclear generated energy is due to finish by, I think, 2030. The draft energy strategy says that there'll be no new oil and gas E&P going forward. So from where do you think that the non-intermittent generation will come? And given that, just something that I saw on the 17th of March, Torness was producing, I think, 42% of the electricity produced in Scotland. When do you think that replacement will actually happen?
So what we're looking at is the huge opportunity for offshore wind primarily in Scotland, although our focus is obviously on all offshore renewables, so tidal and wave energy as well. But the biggest focus for us is on offshore wind. Now, obviously this comes with issues. There's a huge opportunity in terms of building this out, because if we're looking at an electrified system, electrifying everything in Scotland, so this is from domestic heating and everything else comes along with it, the times of year when we're producing the most wind generally is in the winter, and then there's a big opportunity to be heating homes with it, you know, through heat pumps and everything through the winter. So hopefully we'd see actually a nice matching of demand and supply. In terms of the baseload, what you've correctly highlighted, that there is an issue with intermittency here. One thing that we are pushing as a catapult quite strongly on is innovation and programs to develop green hydrogen. There's a lot of work that we've been doing into working out how it integrates both with offshore wind and with the wider energy system. But the hopes are that if we're able to generate green hydrogen using, you know, Scottish and UK electricity, clean electricity from offshore wind, and we're able to find ways of storing this, and you can manage both short-term or medium-term intermittency and long-term seasonal fluctuations in demand, because you do get periods like we had this winter of several days with low wind. So the idea is to be able to use green hydrogen to bridge that gap. And obviously there's a big opportunity here, both in terms of UK jobs, UK economy, benefiting from developing this locally, as opposed to the current system where we are largely importing a lot of our gas.
Thank you for that. Claire Lavelle, I'll move to you. Taking that answer, which was interesting but didn't answer something that that I posed, which was essentially when does the green hydrogen, when does the solar, when does any other renewable technology get to such a point that we can generate non-intermittent energy such that we have no further need for nuclear in generated energy or oil and gas generated energy?
So I think it might be helpful to give a bit of a context, so maybe to split the forms of electricity supply and demand into intermittent, which our renewables are, base load but inflexible, which something like nuclear or biomass and carbon capture and storage is, and flexible forms of renewables. And looking across the work of the ESO and the Future Energy Scenarios and the Climate Change Committee, they've modelled lots of different scenarios and outcomes of different balances of all of those sets of technologies. What we do have in the flexible bucket are just a vast range of technologies that can offer the solution to matching intermittent renewables. So everything from storage, batteries, pump hydro, hydrogen power production, and interconnection as well, will all, in a UK-wide system, be able to manage our supply and demand. And so actually what we do need is a very careful transition to make sure that as generation comes offline, as the demands of our energies shift to increasing electrification, that we make sure that the uptake of all of the next set of technologies that are going to help us manage that flexible system come online. And that is part of the work of the ESO, to do that wider system planning and to really understand how that plays out in a Scottish context in the selection of technologies and solutions that we need to make the Scottish market work within the context of the wider UK market.
Thank you. Final question for me in this section I'll put to Emily Rice. The Climate Change Committee was rightly mentioned there by Claire Lavelle. They have said, amongst many interesting things, that there will be more frequent and more intense weather events going forward as we become more subject to the renewable energy generation. Do you think, Emily, that there is a risk that if we put so much development and time into renewable technologies such as solar and move away from things like nuclear and North Sea oil and gas, that we are increasingly subject to the risks that the Climate Change Climate Change Committee has warned us of and our energy security is threatened?
Thank you for the invitation and thank you for the question. I don't think that renewables and threaten our energy security at all. I would say that climate change threatens our energy security far more than renewable energy does. I also don't think that, I think variable is a better term for solar than intermittent. Our technologies are variable, certainly. One thing we're very lucky about in Scotland is that when it doesn't tend to be too windy, it's sunny. And when it's not sunny, it does tend to be windy. So we do have natural resources that help balance each other out. With grid, with other large-scale storage technologies that work very well with solar energy and with wind energy, I don't think that moving to a completely renewable generation will threaten our energy security at all.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. The next questions are from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Yeah, thanks. If I can just pursue that a little bit more. So, I mean, Claire, you were talking about there being a sort of bucket of flexible technologies that can be deployed, kind of dispatchable technologies. Is there a route to market, though, for each of those? So I think you mentioned pump storage. I think you mentioned thermal generation as well, which could involve CCS, battery technologies. Is there an effective route to market for those, or are there some which are more far market than near market?
So I would say emerging routes to market. So for some of those, the market opportunity is near and established. For other ones of those, such as pumped hydro storage, there's an emerging route and an engagement that is going on with UK government to be able to identify those full routes to market, but there isn't yet a fully established route. So if I take hydrogen as an example, the UK government have started to develop hydrogen business models. They have identified funding to be able to support the first set of blue and green hydrogen projects coming to market. And so there is a route to market for the first tranches of development, but there's more work to be done to develop other aspects of the hydrogen economy. So, for example, things like transportation and storage of hydrogen at a wider scale is not yet being developed, and it is still in progress and still in consultation with the market. So an emerging position, but we do not yet have the final solution.
Mm-hmm. Stuart, can we go to you, and we'll take the rest of the panel?
On the same question. Yeah. So I think I'm usually more concerned with storage on the longer duration timescale. I've talked quite well about storage for balancing electricity on sort of minutes, hours, couple of days, whereas I'm much more interested in providing storage between summer and winter, or storage for a week of low wind weather. And we know that at the moment we do that by just pumping harder on our methane gas supplies, so we don't actually really see the need for storage. But as we shift more to this mixed system, where there is no inherent base load really, but you're always balancing the different types of energy supply, then I see there will be a much increased role for storage in the future. And that's probably going to be chemical energy at very, very large scale. And chemical energy you could describe as methane, but obviously that's, and many countries store methane in Europe, but we'll probably be looking at hydrogen storage, just as Claire said. And we're doing a lot of work in the University of Edinburgh on hydrogen storage, and that looks extremely feasible, both in sandstone rocks and in salt rocks. But the problem for Scotland, if we take a very parochial view on that, is that there's not much storage available geologically in our part of the UK. So again, we're going to be driven to a UK solution to that on a UK-wide storage. And just to highlight the quantity of storage, both Scottish Gas Networks and DNV have just recently done a report which suggests that if we consider the whole energy system for heating and for electricity, in the future, not just electricity. For heating and electricity, then we'll be needing to store something like 15 to 25% of our annual energy, which is a huge amount, but is actually very similar to what countries like Germany and France and Netherlands store just at the moment for the gas supply. And I think that is in progress, as we say, but is going to be needed much sooner than the progress is suggesting at the moment. So one of the things I think the committee could ponder is, should we be moving ahead much faster with hydrogen? Because whichever way you look, hydrogen is going to be part of the system. So that it's a no-regrets option to be investing in hydrogen now and within the next 2 years, rather than waiting till 2030.
Back to a bit more depth in hydrogen later on. But Emily, can we go to yourself?
Certainly. Solar is quite a mature technology. I wouldn't say that it's an emerging one, but we do. It is a technology that I think works uniquely well with storage as well. If we're still speaking about, you know, kind of emerging markets and things, solar is, as I said, it's a mature technology. It's incredibly versatile. It works in, you know, businesses, homes, utility scale, and especially on the, you know, the residential side of things, we're seeing some interesting kind of pilots and routes emerging to help with reduce the cost of electrification of heat. So with solar and storage to reduce demand peaks across Scotland, but also, you know, to help consumers who maybe aren't able to, you know, immediately install a heat pump, soften their energy costs of electric storage heating and things like that. We're also seeing some innovation in terms of agri-PV, so using solar panels to protect especially soft fruits like raspberries on the East Coast. Solar can be installed above those. And so we are really hoping that, you know, these kinds of solar continue to find routes to market, but also that we see a growth in utility-scale solar in Scotland.
Yeah, I'd just like to agree with what Stuart was saying about using this for seasonal storage of hydrogen is probably the option. One thing I would say is that green hydrogen is not the silver bullet that's going to solve all our problems. It's kind of it's almost the last thing you do after you, when you generate a megawatt hour of electricity from a wind turbine, you want to use that as effectively as possible. So the most effective way is to put it into a heat pump, use it for whatever power demand you need. It's only once you get beyond that point and you have no effective use for it and that would be curtailed that you start looking at generating hydrogen or coming up with alternative uses. Now, at the moment, this is getting slightly into the market side, but there's not necessarily an incentive for wind power developers to start developing electrolyzers, because at the moment they get paid their CFD, they get paid their set amount for every megawatt hour they generate. But when we look at a broader market, then that's when you start seeing shifts in wholesale price and opportunities for businesses to start developing green hydrogen production facilities when prices are low.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, just before we leave that, so if we were able to go more to a hydrogen system, and I know members are going to ask this afterwards, would that get rid of the need for constraint payments, which are quite big?
Yes, it depends where the electrolysers are sited, because you could have a system where they're centralised and you have power from all over the country that's kind of excess power that goes to them. The other alternative is that you're generating them at the wind farm sites and then finding ways of, again, like Claire was saying, that you have to transport them, the hydrogen, to market.
Okay, very briefly, Claire, if you want to come back, you're going to give me the good news, constraint payments no longer paid.
In all of these, there's a market solution and there's a technical solution. So all of these range of technologies can help with the technical solution, which can be just investment in more infrastructure, but it can be use of these various technologies to remove the constraint. But the constraint payments are part of the market design, so you also need to assess impact on the market design to be able to remove the use of constraint payments as well. So both have to be considered in parallel.
I always think it's difficult justifying payments for doing nothing, which I think the public find difficult as well. Sorry, the next questions come from the Deputy Convener, Fiona Hislop. Fiona.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us. I'd like to discuss wind power and the readiness of the electricity network. So what do you think are the key barriers to achieving the ambition for offshore wind contained in the draft energy strategy from the Scottish Government? Could the readiness of the electricity network to accommodate new projects affect the business case for the proposals? So what needs to be done to our electricity network in the short, medium and long term? And maybe come to you first, Tom, and then to Stuart.
Yeah, sure. So there's a number of barriers to achieving the targets that have been set out by the draft strategy. We're probably less focused at the offshore renewable energy catapult on the transmission side. We obviously see that there's constraints. There's various solutions to this that we're investigating, such as high voltage DC cabling and potential East Coast connectors between Scotland and demand centres further in the south of England. But there's other barriers that we also need to address, such as the readiness for other infrastructure in Scotland, such as ports and manufacturing capability. So we need quite high levels of investment in order to create the opportunity here. And you can almost view it as there's two two ways of viewing this. One is that if we don't invest in certain areas of infrastructure, such as ports, the projects can't go ahead because you have to have the ports to be able to assemble wind turbines and get them to site. The other risk is that if we don't invest in things like manufacturing, we're going to be losing out on jobs and the supply chain growth and the benefits around that. So there are some risks on that side. The other challenge that we're seeing is around skills. So obviously in the north of Scotland, we've got lots of oil and gas workers at the moment. There's, in some cases, a natural transition for some of those roles into offshore wind, but it's not always a like-for-like. The roles are slightly different. So we're investigating with industry what the different pathways are and the skills that will be required. But I think on the infrastructure side, yes, we obviously need some fairly significant upgrades in the grid, but there's also other options here in terms of power to X. So this is, I mean, hydrogen's one example of that, but there's other solutions.
It is the electricity network we've got particular interest in. So, Stuart, if you can maybe focus on that, that would be helpful from your oversight on this.
OK. So I'm not the world's expert on the electricity network in Scotland, I want to say that. But from talking to colleagues and from several years of observation, I think the connectivity through the landmass of Scotland is going to be a big, slow blockage in connecting a lot more of the offshore wind into our grid network. Because if we're looking at developing the ScotWind suite of projects around the north coast, which is a huge offshore wind potential, then getting that electricity to the market is really difficult because you need to come through the landmass of Scotland, and the established network is really nowhere near up to that. And the main constraint there is not the engineering, I guess, but the actual planning permission rate. If we think about the Bewley to Denny history that we've got, then do we want to have another four or five of those? That's going to slow the connectivity of that offshore wind sometime into the 2030s or more. So that raises the question about power to hydrogen. You know, a way of getting access to that offshore wind energy is not to transport the electricity, but to take the electricity to shore or to use that offshore to generate hydrogen and then to transport the hydrogen. That's an option. I've not examined that in huge detail, but that's an option. And I think the other obstacle is locational pricing in the UK system, where pricing of electricity generation further and further away from the centres of demand, the population centres, is more and more difficult commercially to develop because you have a price penalty placed on you. And so these are interlocking and complicated problems, and it's not clear to me how you break through that to give investors the confidence that they're going to be repaid in an adequate timescale if they try connecting in any of these larger offshore assets.
Thank you for that overview. And if I could come to Claire, and I noticed that in ARUP in your submissions, one of the things you said is we would support SSEN's position that Ofgem would benefit from having a more central and explicit statutory obligation to enable net zero. So in terms of the electricity network being anticipatory of demand as opposed to responsive to, perhaps you could give your insight as to what you think is needed for the network in the short, medium, long term.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's been some really positive changes in terms of regulatory reform within the network space just in the last couple of years. So in response to the kind of growth and ambition for offshore wind to deliver the work that Ofgem have been doing in the holistic network design that looks at much more integrated, efficient networks, looking at longer-term solutions, really being confident to invest in the infrastructure that we need, considering the long-term solution rather than considering what's cheapest in the short term but actually doesn't necessarily deliver the most economic solution. A lot of the work that's been happening with Ofgem through the Accelerating Strategic Transmission Infrastructure Programme has given the confidence to our transmission operators to be able to progress and bring forward infrastructure that is going to be absolutely needed to be able to deliver net zero, and it is a really positive step forward. What I would say is that the work that was done for those ASTI projects, which are the accelerated projects, was done in the context of what was understood to be leased through the Scotland programme, so round about 11 gigawatt was assumed at that point. We now have round about 27 gigawatts of new leased projects. We also have further leasing that's coming through the INTOG leasing round, so what was in the regulatory settlement period doesn't represent the full set of projects that are being leased and progressed at the moment. So there is further work that needs to be done to understand the infrastructure needs for those projects as well. I think there's some really big challenges, you know, despite the commitment to deliver that infrastructure, there's still barriers ahead. So it just represents a vast growth in terms of the amount of major infrastructure that will be bringing through the system compared to historically. And so there's some real constraints within the supply chain, both within the kind of technical capability to design and deliver, but actually just the supply of equipment and plant to those projects. And that that needs to be addressed. And I think as well, the planning process has represented a significant blocker to bringing projects and expediting through the system. And we need to be much slicker in terms of how we design and progress those projects. I could talk a bit about hydrogen in response to
I'm going to come
Stuart,
on to that in a
I
second.
I could leave that to...
Yeah. We can maybe ask Emily what is needed for solar from the electricity network.
So first and foremost, I think for solar, having a kind of level of national ambition would be hugely helpful. So setting, you know, a deployment ambition by 2030. And that's because at the moment, solar tends to be a bit of a footnote in DNO strategies. So DNOs are required to justify all of the investment that they make in their network. And at the moment, because there's no signal from the government saying we want this amount of solar to be included in the energy mix, DNOs don't account for solar when they're making, you know, when they're justifying their investment to Ofgem, to the regulator. And so without that ambition, solar simply isn't included in DNO strategies, and it's harder for solar to get grid. As far as the regulatory regime, I completely agree with what Clara said, that, you know, there's been a lot of progress in the past couple of years, but as it stands, the grid is not designed for the system that we're moving to. It's over the past 20 years, you know, the price of renewable electricity has dropped dramatically, and the way that the grid was designed and regulations were set up, the regulators simply weren't expecting there to be a lot of small-scale renewable generation connecting to the grid, and so it's just not set up to kind of expedite that process. It's not set up to invest ahead of need, which is really what, you know, solar needs. Like every other technology, we just need more investment in the grid. We need more capacity. It's not a, you know, it's not a question of if you build it, they will come. We are already here, and we are asking very much for grid space. So giving the networks kind of that freedom to invest ahead of need, to build out further, to kind of design a grid that's designed, you know, for net zero and not try to adapt what we have for, you know, these kinds of new technologies that we didn't expect 30 years ago.
Much. I saw some nods from the panel there as well. If I can move on to the potential for generation and the market ambition, particularly in relation to hydrogen. I was at Grangemouth Ineos yesterday and hearing about their plans with the ACON project, which was very interesting indeed. So, Professor Hazeldine, if you could perhaps maybe give us a point in time view now as to where you think hydrogen could be, and particularly the movement to green hydrogen, and, you know, in terms of that offshore generation, that balance between it going on into the grid or the potential for it to be used for hydrogen. Are we in a different place now than we were perhaps even 12, 18 months, 2 years ago? And, you know, how optimistic are you that we can shift the dial on the hydrogen side of things?
Okay, so we've certainly, there's plenty of studies happening, plenty of opportunities for hydrogen, lots of enthusiasm for hydrogen, but I still think we need to be cautious or realistic about the availability of green hydrogen in the immediate term, because that depends on having the availability of, firstly, of lots of electrolyzers, the equipment which can pass current through water to make hydrogen and oxygen. So those electrolyzers are not yet fully commercially available at the scale and the numbers you need. And you then need a lot of electricity to supply those electrolyzers. And we, although we're progressing very well on producing lots and lots of low-carbon electricity, as we've discussed earlier in this meeting, then you're going to need even more if you're trying to use that green hydrogen to replace the methane gas. So it's going to, I see that as a slow and continuous progress, but that will possibly take 10 or 15 years to get to anywhere you want to be. And so I think we also still need to look at blue hydrogen, which is the hydrogen by splitting methane molecules into CO2 and hydrogen. And obviously there's a big push from oil companies to sell methane, which could then be split into hydrogen and CO2. So no surprise that oil companies are interested in selling us lots of methane. But we have to be a bit careful we don't get locked into a cul-de-sac there by investing for 30 years or 40 years of blue hydrogen and squeezing out the market for green. But so there's a balancing act to be achieved there. And of course, we may or may not come to later at the moment, in the Scottish part of the UK here, then we have no ability to take away that CO2 from blue hydrogen to store that. So that ACORN project and the associated Scottish cluster of carbon capture and storage, that has to be enacted to enable blue hydrogen to exist. Otherwise, we'll be a nation which is exporting all our CO2 by shipping or by pipe down to storage sites further south in England and that part of the North Sea, and losing a lot of value. So in summary, I see green hydrogen progressing, but not immediately fast. The price of green hydrogen in Scotland can fall. It's projected to fall as the equipment becomes more and more standard, as the pricing decreases. The price of green hydrogen projected to fall by about half by the late 2030s. But how fast we get there is not known to me at the moment. And of course, there's no pipeline system yet, and that's a clear and present need which needs to be sorted out.
Tom, do you want to comment?
Yeah, there's a few areas here. A big focus for us is on innovation. So we're at the moment, the innovation and funding background is a bit scattered, so lots of different sources, and it's not enough to enable us to move from where we are now, from doing feasibility studies through to actually executing on strategies. So there's a requirement for greater funding in the green hydrogen space. I'd agree with Stuart that, yes, we need to build this out. We can't do it at the risk of sending electricity to electrolyzers and then having to backfill with more natural gas for power. That doesn't make a lot of sense. There is some demand for hydrogen. It's going to be a little bit difficult to balance the demand and the supply sides. We'd expect, once we start to grow supply, that a market would be created around that in order to use the green hydrogen. Main focus for us at the moment is on that innovation and R&D space. We think it's definitely possible to reach the targets that have been set of it's 5 gigawatts by 2030 and then 25 gigawatts by 2045. It's definitely possible to reach those, but the short-term goals of matching the supply and demand is going to be challenging.
Just finally to you, any comments on this? And it's that balancing between, I suppose, offshore generation transmission and the potential for green hydrogen. And at what point does that get an equilibrium, or is that from one of the kind of market challenges?
It's a challenging target. So 5 gigawatts by 2030, 10 gigawatts in the UK. And to give you an idea, it took 20 years for the UK offshore wind industry to reach 10 gigawatts worth of installed capacity from a standing start, and albeit that didn't necessarily represent the technology's ability to deliver, but the sustained support that you need to be able to grow and accelerate an industry. There are some very mature technologies, both in blue and green technology, so electrolyzer technology has existed for 100 plus years, but what we don't necessarily have is deployment at scale, and you know, particularly for green hydrogen, we don't have the pipeline yet that we need, although we think that's likely to be emerging with the business model funding. I think one of the really big interdependencies with the network is around the establishment of the future system operator. So now we largely plan our electricity network independently of our gas network, and the establishment of the FSO is to make sure that we do better system-wide planning so we understand how those systems interact and how we can deliver overall much more efficient systems that deliver better outcomes for consumers. The FSO is due to be established 2024, I understand, so we're really a little way away from being able to get to the point where we're actually doing that properly efficient system planning and understanding what we need in gas, hydrogen networks that complement our electricity networks, and that desperately needs to be accelerated, so that is not moving at the pace that we need.
Thank you.
Thank you. Stuart, you made a comment there which I couldn't let slip by about the Beauly to Denny line and the time it took. Do you think it could have been speeded up if we'd thought about undergrounding it? And I will declare that I was involved in it from an environmental point of view.
I'm trying to remember back. So a large number of the objections were certainly concerned with the scenic aspects, let's call it, or the landscape impact. And so I guess you could, in principle, underground that. But I do remember at the time electricity companies provided us with lots of evidence that undergrounding would bankrupt them somehow. But these are choices we have to make in terms of planning, and that's part of, I guess, what the political landscape can help with in Scotland. But there's no doubt that in any of these things, planning is a huge drag on progress. But of course, you've got to balance democracy and local citizens with what's engineering or technologically feasible.
The upgraded power lines will follow the best route, which is where the 132 kVs are, which means that they will not dismantle those till they put up the next one, and then they'll want to keep the old ones up as well, which a solution is to underground them. It's just an observation.
I didn't say that. You said that for me, just to be clear.
Well, I'd love you to say it as well, sure.
That could be an engineering solution, but I'm absolutely not qualified to say if that's a sensible
thing to do. Thank you. I just made the comment. Monica, the next questions are from you.
I want to turn back to the draft energy strategy. I note that it doesn't have specific ambitions for marine or solar deployment, and on hydro, it does recognise the potential role for hydro, both at small scale, involving local communities, and at a larger scale. But I just wonder if the panel can explain whether it is important to have specific targets, and if so, what they should be. Now, I'll start with Emily, because I think you said that solar is a bit of a footnote in the strategy. So keen for you to elaborate on that, and this question about targets, how important is it?
Absolutely. So when I said that there tend to be a footnote in DNO strategies, essentially because we don't have that national ambition, although we do have a strong rooftop market in Scotland, when the DNOs, the district network operators, look at designing their investments, at designing their grids, and solar is different from wind and other technologies because it connects at a distribution level most of the time instead of a transmission level. They have to go to Ofgem with these plans, these spending plans, and say, this is how we're going to invest our money, and this is why. And if there's no national ambition for solar, there's not evidence for them to say, well, the industry is telling us that they're going to put in 4 gigawatts of solar by 2030. That's not really a strong enough reason for Ofgem to say, yes, then you should invest to plan for that. But if the Scottish Government says we'd like to have 4 gigawatts of solar by 2030, then Ofgem will say, right, that's why you're preparing your network for that, because the government has signaled that they want that to be part of the energy mix. It's incredibly important not only for that kind of confidence for the district network operators, but also if we're talking about supply chain, investing now in things like building up skills, increasing making sure that we have a good supply chain of the materials that we need to deploy that amount of solar. It really increases investor confidence to know that there is, in fact, a supported market in Scotland that, you know, people can come and invest in. I've had many solar developers say there's a lot of land in Scotland, but I'm just not sure about the planning system and things up there, but definitely utility scale is starting to turn towards Scotland as an option. So there's a lot of reasons that we think a national ambition is important, and grid is certainly an important part of that, but so is skills and investing in the sector ahead of 2030.
Thank you, Emily. Before I move on to the rest of the panel, what would a realistic ambition or set of targets for solar look like in the strategy?
Is that for me?
Solar, what would the targets look like if they were to be realistic? What would satisfy you?
We believe that 4 to 6 gigawatts could be deployed by 2030. And we believe that that is a kind of, it's a reaching ambition, certainly, but it is a realistic one. We've seen record deployment in Scotland and over recent years. And the industry continues to take off, and with the national planning framework supporting more development of utility scale solar, we believe that there's absolutely no reason to think that we wouldn't be able to reach that by 2030.
Thank you. And I'll come to Tom next, just to ask again about specific targets for marine solar and hydro. So I don't know if you want to answer across the board or just pick out one.
So I think focusing on the marine energy, so the wave and tidal, targets have been very useful for offshore wind, and we are fully behind the ambition. I think that's a good thing. For wave and tidal, they're still at a fairly early stage. We've seen some kind of smaller scale projects, some pre-commercial projects, and so setting targets for these is going to be more challenging. But the ambition's good. What we then need to do is actually get from setting the targets to actually creating all the enabling actions to deliver on those targets. So we're supporting government and industry on identifying what the barriers are, trying to quantify them and work out ways to remove them. But for certain offshore renewables, it's almost more important to have an annual target of what you want to be doing in every year, rather than having a very big target in 2030, which means we have to build a lot in a short period of time without having that longer term view of, well, what happens after that? Have we just overbuilt everything and then are not going to be building more further out into the future? So it's having that steady, clear pipeline of projects that will encourage investors and supply chain and give visibility to the grid and everything else that comes along with it.
Thank you. Claire?
Agree. I think targets help and signal an intent. And the only thing that I would add is I think we also need better system planning. So understanding what's going to be delivered and where, both in terms of transformation of demand to low carbon solutions and the supply of electricity or otherwise to those systems, helps us plan our networks better. And there are very long lead infrastructure items, so the sooner that we can plan for that, the better.
Thank you. And Stuart, anything to add?
Nothing majorly to add, except I believe targets are useful to signal the intent, particularly when you're putting in large capacity for the future, whether that's a pipeline or whether that's an electricity wire. But I'd also say that not everything needs a development target, because some of these technologies are still in the pilot and demonstration phase. They're not, some technologies are not ready to build yet.
Okay. The technologies that we've just discussed do receive less attention in the draft energy strategy. Do you think that any or all of them can play a significant role in the Scottish electricity system? And today we've heard a little bit about the important role that the planning system can play, local government more widely. Our committee just had a big inquiry into the role of local government in delivering net zero, and we had a committee debate last week. I'm sure you were all listening in the chamber to that. But I just wonder if you have a view on how best local authorities can support these ambitions. Skills have been mentioned, planning, but is there anything else that you would want to add to that? And maybe just come to Stuart first and go back along the table.
Well, answering in a very general way, I think not on a specific technology, but I think local authorities can easily be overwhelmed by the technical asks and the detailed asks, which they've been totally unskilled for and totally unaccustomed to. So I've often thought it might be useful to have a more central facility in Scotland to dispense information and disperse information, which COSLA group of authorities, for example, could draw upon that central expertise to help when they're faced with a sudden application for the world's best tidal development and they know nothing about it. How are they going to decide? So skills for local authorities and help with them.
Thank you. Clear.
Yeah, I mean, planning plays a large part of it, and I would defer to Scottish Renewables, who you'll meet with in the later session, that I think will be able to speak more credibly than I can about the application of the planning system. I think maybe the other thing to be aware of is the role of local authorities in development of local heat and energy efficiency strategies. So they play a really critical role in terms of planning for decarbonisation of demand and supply within their local authority areas. And I think that's an area that needs enough appropriate resource to be able to support those local authorities to be able to implement those plans. And I think in particular there's some areas where within their own assets, estates, that they've got opportunities to really catalyse activity and catalyse investment. So I think if you look at hydrogen, creating a demand, a transport demand for fleet, public sector fleet, as an example, can be something that really helps kickstart some of these new industries.
And we have seen some examples of that on some of our visits to Aberdeen, where we saw hydrogen bin lorries, for example. Tom.
So we work with some local authorities already through some clusters around the UK that are centred around, you know, offshore wind development. I think, you know, I can use this opportunity to invite any local authorities that are looking at marine energy and offshore wind, as we are independent experts on this. So we're always welcome to support on that front.
Thank you. And Emily.
Yes, so the planning system, we definitely welcomed some of the changes in the national planning framework for. Again, some of these, you know, encourage local authorities to approve projects that help with that help reach government ambitions. So going back to why ambitions are important, having, you know, that sends a clear signal to local authorities as well. I definitely agree with the point that Claire made about resourcing local heat and energy efficiency strategies. And also just making sure that local authorities are being able to resource and invest in the skills and the people that they need to kind of to approve these projects, to resource these projects, and supporting them to invest in skills as well, so that the benefits of the renewable transition in terms of jobs, in terms of infrastructure, stay in those communities.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Monica. The next questions come from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Good morning, and thank you, panel, for coming along. I'm going to go back to hydrogen, if you don't mind. The draft energy strategy says that Scotland has a strong ambition for the hydrogen economy. With that in mind, what do you think that the potential uses or the markets that we have for hydrogen are adequately understood out there, and what needs to be done to allow businesses to invest with confidence? Claire, I'll come to you first, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I think there's a vast range of solutions where hydrogen can play a role. What I would say is that there's a kind of hierarchy of interest, and, you know, in particular there are applications where electrification as a decarbonisation solution just doesn't work or it's very challenging. So we have a lot of industrial process that needs really high heat that is difficult to do for electrification. There's a lot of transport solutions where electric vehicles, things like shipping and heavy goods vehicles, can't really don't work from an electrification purpose, and that creates a significant demand, and we should really accelerate and focus on the use in those applications where we know hydrogen is the solution. There's some wider debate on the wider range of roles that hydrogen can play in other applications, and in particular something like heat. You know, there are diversity of opinion about where hydrogen is the best solution, but that could have a huge impact in terms of the range of hydrogen that we need to produce and where we need to deploy it. And so I think it's really critical that we make some short-term decisions and what are the no regrets, kind of easy win solutions, and really accelerate and progress those. But we need to really work hard in terms of building the evidence base and deciding the wider set of applications where we're going to use hydrogen.
Okay. Tom, have you got?
Yeah, so I guess on the market side, something that's supported renewable development and deployment over the last 20 years has been the ability to have an off-taker of last resort, so make sure that whatever you generate is able to be sold and get some revenue for. So I think that's something that would be pretty critical for green hydrogen production. A potential option for that is the gas grid, which can, from my understanding, not very technical, can absorb some hydrogen into the grid without having to be adapted. In terms of the innovation challenges that we're facing, we're working with other catapults in a hydrogen innovation initiative to help coordinate and address some of the challenges around all aspects of the hydrogen market and the design of that. And I think just finally, we're seeing a lot of activity in the EU, a lot of funding going towards green hydrogen. I think it's quite important that we don't lose out our competitive advantage on this front.
Okay. Ms. Stewart, do you have anything that you would like to add?
Okay. So again, I just go back to what we touched on briefly before. If we look at the whole system of energy, then one of the main storage opportunities for energy between seasons is chemical energy, is hydrogen. So as well as examining individual examples on a sort of local scale, on an immediate scale, like Claire just discussed, I think we also need to bear in mind that larger grid operation scale, where hydrogen may be preferred for the security it gives in storage, even though in a particular application, electricity sometimes may be better. In many places, electricity is better. So that's one thing to consider. Don't lose sight of the large scale as well as the small scale. And I'd totally agree that on vehicles or transport, whether it's HGVs or buses or shipping or trains, then hydrogen does seem to have strong advantages there. And one of the hidden costs we've looked at briefly was that if we install batteries in a lot of these big vehicles, then the axle weight increases. So you actually end up with a huge potential for more road damage, which ends up with local authorities as an unforeseen problem. So again, we need to be wide-ranging in our review, but building centres and fleets is a way of disseminating hydrogen at low risk into the vehicle fleet, big vehicle fleet.
You said earlier that one of the key barriers you felt was that there was no pipeline system in place for hydrogen at this present moment in time. How do you think, is there anything else that needs to be addressed in regards to the infrastructure, or how can we address those issues?
Well, from my perspective on it, yes, Tom's quite right. You can in principle feed hydrogen into the existing gas grid, but we need to be generating that hydrogen somewhere. The logical place to do that in Scotland would be at St Fergus, where the methane comes onshore, and you're probably aware of that. So at the moment we're stuck on that one. But there's also still a quite huge design problem. If we were to use hydrogen for heat pervasively through domestic housing, there's the switchover problem about how you're going to scale up that percentage of hydrogen into the grid and how you're going to convert houses. And in some cases, how you're going to, it's maybe necessary to if you're supplying an electrolyzer through the gas grid, that electrolyzer needs 99.9% pure hydrogen, needs really, really pure hydrogen. So there's also a purification or a polishing of hydrogen for, before the final use. And all these are actively being investigated, but it's not clear who's going to move first, when and how, to me.
Claire, you're looking at me. Do you have anything to add?
It might be useful to split the two different types of gas networks. So there's a gas distribution network that supplies directly to people's homes for use in heating and cooking. And we have gas transmission network, which is about bulk transmission of gas through the country. And while certainly there is discussion and debate and a decision not yet made on the role of hydrogen within the gas distribution network, and that decision isn't due until 2026, there absolutely is a need to have a gas transmission network that we connect all of our hydrogen production hubs and distribution of hydrogen around the UK and to Europe as well, to make sure that we've got an integrated transmission system. And that is a decision that we should be making sooner rather than later. That's one of the recommendations by the Climate Change Committee, that due to the long lead time of that infrastructure, that we need to start to progress the plans. There is plans for a European backbone, there's plans for Project Union. I think there's more of the work that we could do in identifying the production opportunity of hydrogen within Scotland and how that feeds into those wider plans to make sure that that's fully integrated into whatever decisions we make on our gas transmission network.
Okay. The Scottish Government's ambitions for...
Sorry, just before you move on to your next question, which I don't want to stop you in mid-flow, Colette's quite keen to come in on a point on one of the points that's been raised. So I'm happy to bring you in, then come straight back to you, if I may.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener, and good morning. I just based on what you were talking about in terms of, I wanted to touch upon district heating systems and notwithstanding hydrogen, but... I actually sit on the Criminal Justice Committee. One of the things that's come up in the past is using prison estates as district heating systems in order to deliver energy throughout and also create a revenue there. So I actually wanted to ask Stuart about that as well. If you want to comment quickly, and I don't want to... steal Jackie's thunder here.
And so whoever doesn't look away first.
Well, I'll observe we have a district heating system in the University of Edinburgh, which has four or five different district heating systems in and around the town. And the value in that is the efficiency of the centralised heat through methane gas. At the moment, the university is a bit stuck in its decarbonisation, to wonder whether to carry on burning gas or to switch to hydrogen or to totally electrify. So that's not an answer, but it's an example of the difficulty in making a decision of what's going to be the future.
I don't know if anyone else wants.
Just that all there are solutions in heat decarbonisation in electrification heat pumps, which are an absolute must, and we should accelerate. In heat networks, there are areas where that makes a lot of economic sense when you can find low carbon sources of heat beside demand, and we should accelerate those. And I think the wider question is, what does the role of hydrogen within heating, and are there areas that are difficult to decarbonise by the other solutions that actually hydrogen plays a really key role, and where should we accelerate those? So it's really about understanding the best solution for the best application, of which heat networks are absolutely one.
Thank you.
Push that as far as I can allow it to go, just because of the shortness of time. Jackie, back to you.
Thank you. It was just to go back to Claire. I was going to ask you a question regarding the Scottish Government's ambitions for 5 gigawatt of hydrogen production by 2030 and 25 by 2045. How much of that should come from green hydrogen, and what's probably the reality if we're going to get to that? target?
So I think in the short term, blue hydrogen is considered to be lower cost, and actually we have projects within Project Acorn that are very well developed that that could provide hydrogen at scale in the context of the 2030 targets. They're not currently, haven't been selected for funding under the Bayes cluster sequencing process. They were put as a reserve project on the Track 1 cluster, so there's some uncertainty about the route to funding those clusters, and without that funding route, though, that project won't be realised. In the longer term, green hydrogen is likely to be lower cost. Scotland has an absolute excess of renewable resources. We've got a huge capacity just in the ScotWind leased sites alone. And green hydrogen is zero carbon rather than low carbon, so it doesn't create the challenges that you have with blue hydrogen, where you have to do some offsetting by other means. So I think that green hydrogen certainly has to play a major role in 2030, and absolutely it should be the dominant solution by the time that we get to the 2045 targets.
Okay. Does anybody else have...
I just wanted to highlight a risk around blue hydrogen is that, well, one, it creates an import dependency. If you're investing public funds into a hydrogen project, it should be green hydrogen, because we're not going to be reliant on volatile markets. You can obviously see the risk over this winter of relying on international gas markets. So I just wanted to highlight that as a risk of an investing in a big way into blue hydrogen. We should really be investing in the early stage green hydrogen and creating expertise in that we can export to international markets.
Okay, thank you. And my last question, convener, if I can put it to Stuart. Can I ask Stuart, how critical is it for the Scottish electricity decarbonisation for there to be a Scottish CCS cluster?
Well, you've still got this dilemma that we can either have a CCS cluster, which is up to the UK government process to decide whether it's awarding funds or not. If we have a CCS cluster, then we can develop blue hydrogen rapidly. We can develop negative carbon emissions by direct air recapture. We can develop negative emissions by using our biomass to generate hydrogen, or biomass to generate heat. All those options become available. If we do not have a CO2 storage pipeline, then we lose the ability to transfer offshore skills into that, and then we will be dependent on shipping to export any of our CO2 to another part of Europe, whether that's Norway or England. So I still see that the CCS part, in terms of a net zero, a CCS part still essential, because let's remember that net zero still permits some emissions from agriculture or forestry or transport or anything else, but those will be balanced arithmetically by recapturing carbon dioxide. And if we can't send our carbon dioxide away for storage, then that becomes a more expensive and difficult option to get to the net zero.
Okay,
does that
you.
Answer your question properly?
I think what you're saying is you believe it's critical, and I don't want you to put words in your mouth when I say that.
Well, I think it would be very strange to have a whole region of the UK deprived of that low-carbon facility.
And if the rest of the panel don't have a different view, I'll pan back to you.
Well, you've just told them they don't have a different view, so I'm...
if they haven't got anything else to add, sorry, I don't like putting words in people's mouths.
No one's jumping up and down, and thank you for handing back, because we are short of time. I'd like to go to Liam and then come to Colette.
Thank you, convener. I'll pick up that last point, Stuart Hazeldine. The energy strategy, the draft energy strategy, has a presumption against new oil and gas exploration, and at the same time commits to developing Scottish CCUS cluster. Given the key role that the North Sea fossil fuel companies will play in developing skills and funding of CCUS and other renewables, is there a risk, in your view, that the draft energy strategy's positioning might hinder development of a Scottish cluster, to say nothing of other renewables such as hydrogen?
So are you asking me in simple language whether we should continue developing oil and gas, or are you asking something different?
I'm asking if the draft energy strategy, in presuming against new oil and gas exploration, might inadvertently hinder the development of the technologies we've heard so much about.
Well, I'm not in the boardroom of major transnational oil companies, so I don't see why it would hinder a separate development, because they really are, although they use similar skills and similar technologies, then they're entirely separate projects. And so my personal view is that if the UK is heading towards trying to become a net zero economy, it actually makes me wonder when we're going to cross that bridge of saying we actually do stop producing oil and gas, and we do switch with a full heart and mind into trying to decarbonise and build that decarbonisation network. And so the companies who are actively involved in that at the moment are big transnational oil companies who have, in these particular years, I think it's clear, have got plenty of cash in the bank. So it's choices by them rather than the skills portfolio. They're choosing where to invest their money.
Claire Lavelle, Tom Quinn in just a previous answer talked about the important the import risks of blue hydrogen. Your submission talks authoritatively on blue hydrogen and CCUS, and it highlights their role in the transition for the oil and gas industry. But it also notes in your submission that if reliance on gas doesn't reduce, the imports of gas will increase. And you talk about the significant risk to security of supply in an increasingly volatile geopolitical environment. Therefore, if we accept that demand for power in the United Kingdom is likely to remain high for some time, perhaps might increase given certain choices that we make, should this aspect of the energy strategy be reviewed, the presumption against exploration, not only for energy security, but also for the development of things like hydrogen?
I think there's a not simple answer to that, and the Climate Change Committee have a position on this that I think is that I will try and replicate as accurately as I possibly can. I think it is worth noting that we import significant proportions of our gas supply from the rest of the UK, from out with the UK basins, and the carbon impact of doing that is significant. So one of the major issues with gas production is fugitive methane emissions, which is a very pernicious global greenhouse gas, and which in the short term has a very significant impact on, compared to carbon. And looking at the global market of gas, we do need to be concerned about where we source our gas from out with the UK because of the issues of high fugitive emissions in other nations at levels above the UK level. So it's really important that if we are, if we use gas within the system, that we are very aware of where we're sourcing that gas from and the wider carbon impacts of that. It's very important that if we use gas, that we make sure that we abate it at the capture carbon at the point of use. But equally, there is a general need for us to accelerate as quickly as we can our use of hydrocarbons. So we must use less oil and gas within our system to be able to meet our net zero targets. And I think we have to consider with caution any existing exploration activity within the UK when it's not, when we don't know it to be compatible with those net zero targets. So while we do absolutely need to consider security of supply, we should also recognise that actually acceleration of reduction of use is going to be a much more critical element of that, because any additional exploration activity that we do in the UK is unlikely to make us gas independent because of the balance of gas supply that we're using.
Very grateful.
Thanks very much. We come to the next lot of questions, Colette. And I would love to let you in. My problem is I am short of time, and sure. I'd appreciate your input, but if I did stop a committee member getting in, I have to live with them for future sessions. So I'm going to go to Colette.
How very dare you. Yeah, no, thanks very much. And I want to focus in on Ofgem and the energy markets as well. And obviously on the back of the recent review of the electricity market arrangements, where they touched upon, or the proposal is that they decouple gas prices from electricity produced by renewables. So are you aware of what operational changes Ofgem recently have made to support the delivery of a decarbonised electricity system? And do you think there's more could be done to support a more sort of regulatory regime that delivers a more decarbonised energy supply? And you touched upon that earlier when Liam was asking you about importing gas and the contractual elements, I believe, that the UK are in terms of the prices of importing gas. And I'll ask Claire, since you touched upon that as well.
Yeah, so I'll not talk about the network reform associated with network investment, because I've touched on it, and you have the network operators later in the afternoon that will speak to that. I think the other thing to be aware of is the review of electricity market arrangements, REMA, and that really recognises that there are significant challenges with our current market system. It is clearly not delivering for generators in terms of being able to access the market, but it's not delivering for consumers either, because we are paying some of the most expensive electricity prices across Europe as well. And that market reform is at a very early stage, so it's at consultation stage where there are options on the table, which really go from evolution of what we have at the moment to some big transformation looking at different market models. And that review is going to be incredibly critical to the Scottish market.
Thanks, Claire. Can I bring in Tom on that? Thanks.
Yeah, we're not particularly close to the regulatory side and Ofgem. I would just say, just to echo what Claire said around REMA, it's a spectrum of options. And at the moment, it seems like the consultation responses say that everything is still effectively on the table. And that really highlights what a complex topic this is, that there's not a simple solution to it. For the offshore wind side of things, it's important. You talked about decoupling. It's important that we're generating a lot of renewable energy in Scotland. It would be great for all our consumers to have cheap access to cheap and affordable power, but we need to make sure that we're still incentivising investment in the future projects as well.
Okay, thanks. Emily, do you want to come in on this?
Sure. So again, like Tom said, we're not super close to the regulatory regime, and we certainly welcome the kind of some of the changes that Ofgem has made recently. Overall, I think that regulatory frameworks need to be much more agile than they currently are to kind of allow that investing ahead of need and that innovation ahead of net zero. There are some options I think that solar in particular could benefit from, and I'm not going to comment on whether these are the absolutely correct options or not, but things like decentralizing energy networks, so using network charging to reward consumers who consume local supply, so if you have solar arrays and things like that, and that is completely consumed in the community, then you're not paying transmission charges for transmission that you don't need to carry that power elsewhere. This already happens in places like Portugal and France. It is an option. It would just require kind of that different regulatory regime. And as Tom and Claire have said, there are a vast spectrum of options. Everything's on the table right now, and we are changing. But definitely having that kind of more agile regulatory framework and thinking around some of the more out-of-the-box solutions, I think, will be important.
Okay, thank you. And lastly, Stuart, do you want to come in on this?
Again, I'm not super close to it, as the phrase goes, but I do think that consumers seem to be getting a progressively worse deal as we shift from 100% fossil to 100% everything else. And so anything which gets us further towards effectively a pick and mix menu of cheaper electricity and cheaper power seems pretty sensible, because this transition, we're only part way through this transition. We're going to have to deal with different sorts of renewables, different sorts of methane or gas mixes, and so flexibility and adaptability are going to be important. But it's also important, I think, not to go for totally locational pricing, because then you'll end up with very expensive electricity in the outlying parts of the UK. And so there's a big plus for me about having a postage stamp type of operation where everybody in the UK has a similar price.
I'm going to let you have one more question to one person, say. Sorry. I'm going to ask you to choose carefully in your question and your answerer. I was going to say victim, but I don't think that's right.
So the Climate Change Committee recommended the establishment of a Great Britain wide electricity infrastructure delivery group to ensure that there is effective coordination between the administrations throughout the whole of the UK. Can I ask, do you support this, and what should it be its immediate priorities in that respect? I'll bring in Claire.
Yeah, and I think you're probably referring in that context to the establishment of the future system operator. So that's the evolution of our electricity system operator to bring in gas and electricity planning and to hold more centralised strategic system plans as well. And I absolutely very much welcome that. That is what the industry really needs, to be able to understand the infrastructure that we need that delivers efficiently, that allows us to accelerate net zero, but also allows us to be able to deliver efficiently for consumers as well. So I think that is well supported by industry.
And quickly, because I'm going to get into trouble from the convener, if anyone else wants to come in and comment. If not, happy.
Absolutely not. I'll allow one more person. I'll allow one more person. Say.
Time to collect.
I think we probably got there, Colette, and it was a nice try, and I'm sorry I couldn't let you do that. But can I just say it's been a really interesting session, and I'd like to thank you all for the evidence that you've given this morning. And I think the fact that we started late, but we've run on past the time that we would have had originally, proves how much your evidence was valued. So thank you very much. I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting till 11:05 to allow a changeover of witnesses. I suspend the meeting. Okay, welcome back. And I'd now like to welcome our second panel joining us today as part of our inquiry into Scotland's electricity infrastructure, inhibitor or enabler of our energy ambitions. On behalf of the committee, I'm pleased to welcome Scott Matheson, the Network Planning and Regulation Director, Scottish Power Energy Networks, Aileen McLeod, Director of Business Planning and Commercial for SSEN Transmission, Morag Watson, the Director of Policy for Scottish Renewables, and joining us remotely is Mark Howell, the Chief Technical Officer for Community Energy Scotland. Thank you, first of all, for accepting our invitation. And I know some of you were present during the last session, so you'll have had the benefit of that. We are quite short for time, so not everyone will be able to answer every single question. And for those in the room, if I'm glaring at you, it's because I want to bring somebody else in and to give everyone an equal opportunity to read no more into it than that. The first questions, therefore, come from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I wanted to come back in on that issue around dispatchable electricity and what some of the challenges might be in terms of securing a route to market. So, Morag, maybe sort of start with yourself here, and then if others want to come in, fine. But I particularly want to ask you about pumped storage hydro, but also any other technologies you think where there are particular issues in terms of establishing that clear route to market at the moment.
Absolutely. So to pick up on what Claire Bell said in the earlier section, there is, when it comes to that storage on the grid, there are two issues. There's the technological and how you solve that, and then there's the market mechanisms. So if we look at what has come forward in the Bay's flexibility plan, they're saying we need about 30 gigawatts of flexibility on the system by 2030. Pumped storage hydro could provide around 10 gigawatts of that. It is something that's very distinctive to the geology and geography of Scotland. So there's a little in Wales, but most of that would be in Scotland. The key reason that we are not reaching investment decisions on that is because you need a finance stabilisation mechanism. So these things take decades to build. I don't know if anyone saw BBC News this morning, but the Coire Glas is £1.5 billion worth of investment, 500 construction jobs, but that's over about 7 to 10 years, so you need that patient finance. So the UK government put forward a call for evidence in 2021 for how would this be done, to which we submitted a cap and floor mechanism, which is what you use for interconnectors, the big cables that connect us to Europe, would be technology neutral, but would work for pump storage hydro. That was asked for in 2021, and we've been told they may make a decision on it in 2024. So it's not that it can't be done, it's just the time scales it's taking to reach a decision that is really problematic for industry.
Scott, Aileen, do you want to come in on this pump hydro or any other issues around dispatchable technologies?
I think it's been well covered. The only other thing that I would add is that the functional specification of what's connecting to the grid is important as well. So renewables can have grid-forming technologies associated with them, and we need to see commercialisation of things like virtual synchronous machines at the wind farms. And clearly batteries have a role in terms of balancing this out as well, and have an abundance of battery applications on the system. But they've got to be in the right location at the right area to balance out the system appropriately. Mm. But I think Morag covered it very well.
Yeah.
Can I just add, clearly as grid developers, we're technology agnostic, but we are very concerned about maintaining security of supply. The report from the Climate Change Committee that was published a couple of weeks ago, referred to earlier, very much emphasises that whole resilience aspect of the grid. So their focus on technology independently of actually how that contributes towards security of supply. And when you're thinking about the long-term planning of the grid and having an understanding of how that security of supply is going to be realised is incredibly important if we're going to keep the lights on going forward.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to move on, but I'll maybe come back to you in a minute, Mark. I want to ask you about onshore wind. We didn't discuss this much in the first panel, but I wanted to come back to you, Morag, in terms of asking you how you think the onshore wind target will be delivered. Are we looking at existing sites that have already perhaps been through planning, or you know, have been loitering in the planning system for some time? Are we looking at repowering? Is it a mixture of both?
It's a blend. So just for the understanding of the committee, there's currently a discussion between the Scottish Government and industry for a sector deal on onshore wind. Based on the sixth carbon budget from the Climate Change Committee, Scotland will need an additional 12 gigawatts of wind for net zero. So in terms of where did that come from, we have already as an industry done a project pipeline and analysis of where that comes from. There are approximately 12 developers in Scotland that will deliver those 12 gigawatts by projects that they have in process at the moment. As you say, it will be a blend. What we particularly look at to optimise existing infrastructure is extension and repowering of wind farms. So either add round the edge or repower what you've got, because all the access tracks, the grid connection, the substations are all there already, and that's the most efficient way. The second thing that we look at is clustering. So if you have three wind farms, for example, in a triangle, it makes sense to fill in that area in the middle. And again, that's the most efficient use of land and connection and access and so on. Then once you've done that, then you start to look at greenfield sites. And we are not getting to 12 gigawatts of additional onshore wind in Scotland without greenfield sites. We will need them. The ideal place to put them is closer to centres of population, because again, that minimises your grid cost. But with the Eskdale Muir seismic array outside of Lockerbie blocking about 10% of Scotland across the central belt, a resolution needs to be found for that to enable to unlock development in that area. And that could change our ability to deploy from around about 2 gigawatts in that area to the moment up to 8 gigawatts. So that would be half of what we need to do. So those would be really important.
Okay, so that's still a significant blockage. Can I ask about the electricity network as well? So we had discussion first panel about Beaulieu Denny and other transmission lines. Well, how kind of prepared are we to take 20 gigawatts of onshore wind? Can I go back to Aileen and Scott, and then I'll bring in Mark?
Yeah, I'm happy to pick it up first. So I think we're prepared. We have the technologies, so we've been working over the last couple of years on something called the Holistic Network Design. There's an abundance of acronyms in our industry, as you know. But it lays the blueprint to take us to 2030. And effectively what that will allow us to do is to increase more than double the export capacity that we have from Scotland at the moment. To put that in context, Scotland can export 6.6 gigawatts of renewables in any given day from Scotland via onshore interconnectors and also the Western HVDC link. We have in flight, and Aileen and I are working on two further East Coast DC links at the moment, and there's potentially a further fourth within that sort of 2030 horizon that gets us to round about the 15 gigawatts of export capacity that will support the 25 gigawatts of additional renewables that are coming onto the system. So can we they're offshore, and they help. We're also looking at wherever possible where we can reconductor, so we can put higher capacity conductors in existing towers. We're also looking at high temp low sag, which is an innovation in terms of conductors that allow them to get up to 30% more capacity out of the network. The DC links are not unimpactful with respect to planning and consenting, but they're obviously completely different from overhead lines. But by the time that we get into the 2030s, and we're heading towards that 2040 target of up to 60 gigawatts of renewables from Scotland, we're back on to looking at further onshore upgrades as well as significant offshore upgrades. We know how to engineer these. The two biggest challenges that we have in delivering the infrastructure will be planning and consenting and the supply chains.
Okay. Let me bring in Mark at this point, then we'll go back to Aileen.
Hi, thank you, Anne. Basically, I think the grid experts are in the room rather than here, especially at the transmission scale. I think from our experience, it's much more at a distribution level. I know I welcome the identification by Scottish Renewables that they can get the 12 gig with 12 large sites. I'm quite nervous that we're missing an immediate opportunity of the gap filling. I agree with Scott that some of the biggest challenges acceptability and planning for these things, and we've got an opportunity with more locally and community owned sites at a smaller scale to actually fill a lot of the gaps quicker. I mean, I'm delighted with the offshore wind developments. I mean, and even the news of Corey Glass today on the macro scale and the longer scale. But I think as the driving imperative to decarbonize quicker as well, and to do it up front, is to try and fill in the gaps and take advantage of, as they repowering the smaller sites, expanding and taking advantage of that, and the greenfield sites. There's a lot of gap filling we can do and make better use of the distribution grid and better generation from that point of view, and that's particularly an area. And I think to some degree I see the battle's a wider argument of decarbonisation in a sort of just and inclusive way will be won at that level, and both from the point of view of the absolute generation we achieve, but also getting the ownership and almost people taking responsibility for the network systems, and we're seeing the benefit of that where it's closer to home and closer to the end user.
Yeah, thanks very much. Aileen?
Yeah, so you asked about network readiness, and the title of this inquiry is about inhibitor and enabler. And I think as we sit here today, the grid is an inhibitor, and we heard that in the session this morning. And why is it an inhibitor? It's because we don't have enough. And I'm sure we can explore that further as the discussion goes on. But it's key also that it's an enabler. And Scott described very well the plans that are in place. But we also recognise that there's some critical steps in order to be able to implement this in the near term. And I've got a list of three. Who doesn't love a list of three? And the first one is around about planning. And this isn't about throwing away all the good things that happen in planning. It's around about putting in place a more structured process with clear timelines and clear roles and voices for all involved, in particular the communities. And Bewley Denny has been mentioned. We've learned a lot in the last dozen years since then, and we particularly learned about the importance of engaging early with the affected communities and understanding those impacts. That's not to say there won't be bumps on the road. I'm sure there will be subsequent inquiries. We will talk about this further, but it is a critical aspect. The second one is about commitment. So commitment is key. So commitment to deliver this infrastructure, commitment to the decarbonisation, not changing the rules, not changing the direction of travel, not changing the pace. Why do we need that? Because we're operating in a global environment where we're trying to attract in technology, skills, supply chain has been mentioned a number of times. There was talk this morning about things like investment in ports, infrastructure. If we get the commitment right, then I think we can bring in inward investment and actually drive the economy of our country. And the third one is around about skills. There's a huge opportunity that, the draft strategy came with a just transition element to it. We want to effectively transition from a high carbon economy to a low carbon economy, and doing this in a managed way requires that real planning around about skills development across the whole of our country, so that our young people today can see a future, can see a high value job where they can actually contribute to the social good and the social fabric of our country. So those are my three things: planning, commitment and skills.
Okay.
I'll probably say them again.
That's great. I'm sure we'll keep coming back to those themes.
Yeah, I'm going to go to the Deputy Commissioner, who's got a supplementary on this before I go to the next person, who will be Jackie Dunbar. So, Fiona.
Aileen, I just want to ask, and so we have it on the record, as you said that currently the grid is an inhibitor. Could you maybe just explain why that is and what would address that?
So I think all of the panel members this morning, and Morag could maybe touch on this as well, talked about the challenges of getting connected. Connection dates now extending, a decade into the mid-2030s. Now, why is that? It's because there is insufficient grid capacity. And it was mentioned this morning as well, the level of constraints, and I think that the figure that was used by the National Audit Office earlier this month was up to £62 million a day. And that is a consequence of not having enough grid capacity, that the power that's being generated is effectively not able to access the market and flow forward onto to homes and consumers. That's the situation that has built up over a number of years. There has been, in many people's minds, good reason for that, because of the uncertainty about the future and spending money that potentially was not going to be required. But the consequences we see today is that that shortage is actually costing homes and businesses, consumers, but also the decarbonisation of our economy a lot.
Yeah, I can certainly come in on that one. I think what's probably helpful to the committee is to look at the underlying reason of why we are in the pickle that we are in. And it's because in the past we have always had a responsive grid development. You had to bring forward a clear needs case, demonstrate that more grid was needed, and then you were allowed to build it by the regulator. The reason being that grid is eye-watering, really expensive. That cost gets added to consumers' bills, so you never want to build more than you need. Net zero has entirely changed the game. At no point in the past have we ever had an end point for what we needed our electricity system to do, and now net zero creates that end point. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to plan a grid through a regulation system, and the regulation is there to control, not to forward plan and develop and be proactive. And this is why we find ourselves in this situation, that the Future Systems Operator has been brought forward as a proposal to remedy this, because it would be an entity that plans where we need to go. But as we've said, we're not expecting to see that for quite some years yet. It's bogged down in the Energy Security Bill in the UK Parliament before we can get the legislation to create it. Ofgem are, again, trying to do some processes around, there's a process called ASTI, and I will defer to my colleagues to talk about that, which is about the anticipatory investment in infrastructure. But again, you're asking your regulator, who is there to control, to then start doing proactive, and it's really not what they were ever set up to do. And this is why we find ourselves in this pickle. So looking at the report that came out from the CCC last week, which asked the question, can we have a stable, secure, affordable net zero grid by 2035? Absolutely, yes, we can, but not at the pace of change that is happening right now. All the things that we need to happen to make that a reality are all happening too slowly.
Scott, do you want to add to that? I'll pass back to the convener.
Yes, I guess I'll maybe steal a wee bit from Noam Chomsky here and kind of look at a bit of optimism over despair. So I wouldn't categorise grid as the inhibitor. What I'd say was the catalyst. It's mutually consistent with renewables ambitions. But where I absolutely agree with Morag and Aileen is that we have came out a decade or more of a regulator resisting anticipatory investment ahead of need. They have moved significantly, and we can see that signal through the ASTI over that last year. Even if we just go back a couple of years, we were still struggling with the regulator in terms of that building ahead of need. That has moved significantly. I think that if we can crack the planning and consenting part of the equation, and we can also address some of the major challenges that we've got in supply chain and also capitalise on that in the way that Aileen characterised it, it does have economic benefit. We see significant interest within our company for DC cable manufacturers. Now, we need 5 major DC cables, hundreds of kilometres of cable to be produced, and there's not enough capacity in the world, and those manufacturers want to come to Scotland. So I think there is a unique opportunity through this transition. I think there's a really good metaphor that we use is that at the moment we are in a climate change emergency. We need to treat it as such. If we look at the height of COVID, when we saw what we could do with the vaccine, in 10 months we were able to create and produce a vaccine, whereas normally it would take 10 to 12 years. That's the kind of tectonic change that we need in terms of planning, consenting and supply chain issues to crack this. But if we can get that level of support, then I genuinely think that we can realise Scotland's ambitions here.
And so I'm getting Noam Chomsky on the official report of the Scottish Parliament, convener.
Okay, and I'm briefly going to bring in Liam now on the planning side.
Just on exactly that issue. So, Scott, Aileen, you've both talked about planning as an issue. Now, we've just had NPF4. I think Scottish Renewables were broadly welcoming of the new framework. But Scott first, then, does NPF4 deliver on the planning that you need and that you've just referred to as a challenge?
So it takes us forward, but it doesn't go far enough. I think that we need a planning process that has defined timescales. So if I can quote, so Beauly Denny is one project. We have a live project in southwest Scotland at the moment. KTR, Kendun Tongland. It has been 8 years in the making, frustrated through a planning process for 4 or 5 years. There was 3 years of redesign and changes to accommodate what stakeholders wanted within that area as well. That cannot happen if we're going to build these DC links. As I look ahead to Eagle One, the first that needs to be up and commissioned and operating to export capacity by 2027, so just 4 years from now, I need a planning consent obtained by 2024, first or second quarter. This is not a problem that's unique to Scotland. So I don't want to characterise it as being about NPF4 or that. It's the same. There's no point in building a DC link that has one consent in Scotland, doesn't have a consent in England and Wales. We have the same problem. There's a DCO process with defined timescales, but typically those could be up to 4 years as well. So actually what we need is a fairly big systemic change in the way that we approach this, and that's why I take you back to the metaphor I used earlier. Is if we genuinely believe that we have a climate emergency here, it requires us to authorise and consent this infrastructure in a different way. There is a proposal to bring forward a central networks plan across GB as a whole, which Scotland's infrastructure would also be accommodated in. And I guess one of the things that we can think about, begin to think about, is what role could that actually play in setting out the benefits, including enhanced community benefits, that this infrastructure can deliver against Scotland's targets, and how could that play a bigger role in speeding up the consenting process?
Aileen, anything to add to that?
I obviously agree with that. And I mean, planning is difficult. At the end of the day, there are a lot of complex factors that need to be traded off in undertaking a planning process. Whatever it is that we do here, we shouldn't step away from that, and we shouldn't step away from making sure that there's a robust evidential underpinning and that all voices are heard. And some of the things that Scott talked about, particularly around about things on community benefits on the grid side, can help with some of the sort of transfer of costs and benefits that are associated with that. I would also highlight that there's been significant progress, certainly in the grid sector, the development of our understanding of biodiversity net gain, natural capital types of approaches are chalk and cheese compared with where we were a dozen years ago. And similarly, the involvement in communities, and the example Scott gave there, I could similarly give you examples in the north of Scotland around about changing designs in order to meet community concerns. But the scale of this is absolutely profound, and it may have been a bit, I think Stuart Hazeldine mentioned earlier, you know, four Bewley Dennys, and you know, that is what we are talking about in the north of Scotland. You know, we're talking about major infrastructure builds to the north of Bewley, to the east of Bewley, down the east coast, in addition to these subsea links down to England, across the Murray Firth, and most welcome out to the Western Isles, with all the benefits that hopefully that will bring to that local community. It is absolutely astonishing, and we talk a lot about it being equivalent to what happened in the 50s and 60s. I actually think it's even bigger than that, the scale of the change. So does our current planning system fit that? It's hard to answer that with a yes, but it's also very, very important that we don't diminish all the good things that happen through planning just now in a rush to reform and a rush to move forward.
Thank you. Next load of questions from, I think it's Jackie.
Yes.
I apologise.
Good morning, panel. Thank you for coming along. I'm going to ask Mark a question, if you don't mind, but if any of the other panels would like to come in and add to it, then please feel free. Mark, as you're probably aware, the committee, as part of their away days, visited the Aberdeen Donside Hydro Project, which isn't in my constituency, and we saw the fantastic work that goes on there. Can I ask you what role does local community projects like that have in supplying the current electricity network? And how can we harness their potential moving forward?
Thank you, Jackie. No, it's very relevant, indeed. And I think when we're listening to others there, and I mean, actually, after trying to and thinking about it from the point of view of infrastructure, after spending quite a couple of decades working with communities who are off grid and the challenges and practicalities of that, I'm also a huge fan of the grid. I think at a transmission level, it's been really, really good, and we're well ahead of the curve on that. I think also spending the last 15 years wrestling with the distribution grid, that itself has created a lot more challenges for us. For actually delivering, which is a real shame, because I think generally, if we're going to achieve this quick enough, as touching on earlier, we need to be looking at the distribution and the local supply. The opportunity from having local ownership and community ownership, it was almost touching into the last point about planning. To some degree, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. And genuinely, you see the difference. If someone is invested and someone has some involvement in a project, you take the Donside ones, you can think of many others, you have a very, very different view. And it's nice to hark back to when the hydro first rolled out in the 60s from that point of view. People's idea about it was welcomed. I think if we're going to succeed and take people along with us, is we have to get them. It's not giving out freebies. It's getting people feeling they have some ownership and some stake in it. And by doing that, they welcome it. It's something that happens. I mean, it's three examples in mind when you're up in Orkney, for the point of view that we have a turbine up on the hill. People look up to it and say, it's our turbine. And they smile when they see it. And that's a completely different opposite. It sounds twee, but it really does matter if we're going to take people with us rapidly and do make this change and acceptability, never mind the wider benefit. But things like that. And the other even tweeer example is the island of Chapensea, where the old matriarch of the village actually chopped down her hedge. Originally, can you hear me okay, Jackie? Sorry, yeah. Originally, she was very much against the wind turbine going up in that area, just a 1 megawatt turbine. But when her granddaughter told her that every time we went round, it was 7p for the community, she got her nephew to chop down the hedge so she could see it turning. It's a human example, but it's a real example of if we have local involvement in these infrastructure changes, we'll actually be able to let them happen because we're working together with it, and people taking a stake in it, rather than it's something that's done to them, and at best they object and grumble. It's simplistic terms, but I think that would be absolutely key. But over and above that, I think the thing I've seen most over the last two decades at local energy and community energy is the indirect and second generation benefit you get from getting people involved in generation. If they get involved in generation, then they think about other infrastructure projects, whether that's communications, mobility, all the things the harder things sometimes we're going to have to tackle in decarbonising. You know, I think when we're talking about the emphasis on grid, but early on a lot was talking about hydrogen and chemical fuels and stores and things like that. I still feel they have to be the last resort. I think in first resort we reduce and we have energy efficiency. In second resort we make better connections so we can balance the grid more easily. I'm losing my train a bit here from that point of view. But I think, I mean, the opportunity that when people take on projects like the or balancing, local balancing, and they take an interest in local demand. But to enable that, we have to restructure the infrastructure, not in a physical sense. And one of my colleagues was referring to more the question of the contracting and things like that. For local actors, for smaller actors to be involved, it's de-risking. I don't want to go on too long, but we talked about the Western Isles Interconnector was a really good example there, where you have basically a very large interconnector being put in there. The local population wanted to buy a bit of it, wanted to create an opportunity to have local generation, but the early stages of that, they were prevented because the actual requirement to underwrite and things like that were too high. So the local communities, the local organisation, even the local authority couldn't move quick enough. And we're going to be left in the Western Isles with 140 megawatts that will probably get snapped up by one or two large operators because they're ready to move. And it's actually making sure the system, the contracting, actually de-risks it and allows smaller actors with less deep pockets to be able to interact with the process. I'll stop there.
Thank you. That was really, really interesting. I'm just going to have one more question because I'm conscious of time. I'm going to come to Morag. I asked Stuart earlier how critical is it for the Scottish electricity decarbonisation for there to be a Scottish CCC cluster. Can I have your views on that?
So I will divide your question into two, if I may.
Of course.
CCS and electricity, I will separate them out. In terms of the electricity supply in Scotland, approximately 97, 98, depending on the weather and demand, of Scotland's electricity needs is currently met from renewables. So Scotland is more than capable of meeting its own electricity needs from renewable energy. And likewise, as we decarbonise transport, which is 25% of our energy use, and heat, which is around 50% of our energy use, again, we can have sufficient renewable energy generation to meet that need. in terms of can we achieve net zero without CCUS, then I would defer to much greater experts than myself, such as Stuart and such as the CCC. All the credible advice I have read on this is no, we will need carbon capture and storage. There will be parts of our economy that we cannot decarbonise using electricity, and there will be parts of our economy where we will need to do those compensatory measures that that Stuart talked about, and that's the role that the CCUS will play. So yes, we will need it, but not necessarily in the electricity generation sphere, but certainly in other spheres.
Okay, thank you. Stuart, would you like anything to add?
So I guess what I would say is that, as Morag's pointed out, so about 98% of our supply is from renewables, but there's a plant SSE owned at Peterhead that does help make sure that we can balance out the system. And I think that the way that I would look at this is that there is a transition as we're building out the transmission network, which also enables Mark's community schemes as well. And if I look at SP Distribution, if I can just pick up a comment on that, about 78% of our grid supply points, they're the interface between distribution and transmission, are effectively exporting or constrained at any point in time. So when we're building the bigger superhighway, it's also allowing greater ambition to be realised at the community levels as well. And I think that's increasingly important from a resilience perspective within those communities as well as the economics of it. In terms of the question, in terms of if you look at the winter that we have just came through, there have been points where gas has provided up to 40% of the demand. That's a stark reality. And if you're going to have a period where you're going to rely on that, given that we do believe it's a climate emergency, you cannot have that polluting the world's atmosphere. So you need carbon capture alongside it as well. I'm very, again, optimistic, to use that term. There is a lot of work happening in a university just along the road from here at Heriot-Watt, looking at that. I'd like to see more effort in Scotland looking at the industrial clusters for hydrogen and for carbon capture as part of that to make sure that it's within the armoury. But beyond that, this is not my area of expertise.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Jackie. The next questions are going to come from the Deputy Convener, Fiona Slot. Fiona.
So I'd like to direct these questions to Scott and Aileen. Do the current business plans in relation both to transmission and distribution from SSEN and SPEN allow for sufficient investment in the networks to realise what's in the draft energy strategy from the Scottish Government? I'll come to you first, Scott, and then to Aileen.
Yeah. Well, our business plans to spend around about between now and 2030 or the early 2030s, approximately £14 billion, about £6 billion of that on our distribution networks and about £8 billion of that on the transmission networks. And I know Aileen's numbers won't be terribly dissimilar. One of the things that I do want to say as well is the model that we have, I think, is highly important here. It spreads out the cost of that infrastructure over a 45-year period. The returns are relatively low. The regulator has pushed those down further at these price control reviews, but we believe they can still attract the necessary inward investment that we need into Scotland. What that ultimately means is that for the use of the transmission and distribution network, customers can expect to continue to pay about 40 pence per day going forward. So I think we've got the quantum of investment there, and we also have a number of uncertainty mechanisms in place from the regulator. One of the things that they woke up to was they needed to make the price controls much more agile to allow us, should our ambition accelerate, to be able to trigger that money. I think one of the challenges I would put to the regulator is, are they equipped to process some of those uncertainty mechanisms agilely and quickly in return? We need to see that over the next 12 to 18 month period. We need to see the evidence of their ability to support our ambition alongside it. I think it's also important I say a word or two about what that funding provides. The low carbon transition is not simply about the very high profile headline transmission network. It's also about ensuring that domestic customers can realise their ambition with respect to electrification of vehicles or a transition into, for example, electrification of heat. So one of the things that we have to do is make sure that we address the safety of the electricity network directly within customers' premises. And we have significant funding within the distribution price controls to make sure we're upgrading the very low voltage, the tributaries that serve the end customer, alongside building the transmission network out as well.
Aileen?
The second of the three points on my list earlier was around about commitment, and I think this is this for me is at the heart of these questions about the regulatory framework going forward. So we saw the change that happened early last year with the shift in looking at the UK level, the national kind of strategy that unlocked the big investments that we're now seeing on the transmission system, and saw a shift in the regulatory framework. It's very easy to do that when that spotlight is shining and that shift is happening, but we need to maintain that over the course of the next 10 and 15 years. We're looking forward towards the targets at 2030, of which ScotWind is an absolutely critical part of that, and I refer again to the huge economic benefits that can bring to us in Scotland and personally to the north of Scotland in particular. But beyond that, we're looking to decarbonise our electricity system by 2035. So this is a long and sustained effort, and that commitment is absolutely key. So we've seen a change in the regulator. They have a job to do. Morag referred to earlier as around about control. That's very important. They're acting on behalf of the consumer and making sure that the right decisions are being made. But those decisions need to be made in an agile way, and they need to also take into account the cost of inaction, which is what we see predominantly through constraints today, for example, around about deferrals and uncertainty, if you like, around about the future. So commitment for the long term, a focus on targets. I'll not talk about targets just now because I'll spend an extra 5 minutes talking about that, but really all striving towards that same common goal, whether that is within this building, within the building at Westminster, within the regulator, within those of us who are sort of the key stakeholders in delivery of all of this. We all need to be working together towards achieving it. If any of us start to wibble wobble and flake out, then that sends a signal to all the parties that are involved and probably encourages everybody to take a step back.
And what is the impact of current delays or deferrals, and also any current inflationary impacts on your business plans, probably short term?
Do you want to...
So at the moment we are spending in line. So both companies have spent in line with their overall allowances, and again that's a pretty remarkable achievement when you look at competitors south of the border as well. We have seen inflation go up and down, so I know that inflation has been upwards over the last year, but it's not all that long ago, 2015, 2016, the inflation was actually negative as well. So it kind of swings in roundabouts and evens up going forward. I think probably what my acute concern is going forward is to realise this, and I come back to the theme about, I think the regulator, I have heard Jonathan Brearley publicly say they think they've done their bit with ASTI last year, and I think Aileen's point is very important. We need to ensure they continue to do that going forward. But if we don't get those consents in the time that we need, and we do need support in terms of global manufacturing, the UK, Scotland, is not the only area that's out building major transmission infrastructure. In Holland and Germany at the moment, they're doing the same, and they're placing contracts out to 2037. Our regulatory framework doesn't support that so much at the moment, but we do need those planning and consents, and we do need more resources in the UK to continue to spend in line with the projections that we've made.
And we can address these issues to Ofgem when we see them, and we're very conscious that a number of these issues are reserved areas. So I'm going to focus now on the Scottish Government and maybe come to you, Mark, if that's OK, and ask what more could the Scottish Government be doing to support network investment and readiness?
Oh, crumbs.
And I'll ask the same question of Morag after as well, so I'll give you a bit of time there, Mark.
Yeah.
I was giving Mark a bit of time to think there.
I wasn't sure if you were...
I'm confused. Is Mark...
Mark, do you want to answer that question?
Right, so no time to think, Mark.
Yeah, no, I said... Yeah, with no time to think. No, I think the opportunity... I mean, as I say, so much of it is which makes it quite tricky from that point of view, aligned with Ofgem. But I think making a needs case and supporting especially at the lower voltage level and the user level, that we have a decarbonisation plan for things like domestic heat, for things like mobility and all the rest, that makes that case, that makes that argument for saying we need to rapidly, especially at the distribution level, we need to rapidly reorganise this. So and do it because it's not just about wires and cables. It's about the challenges that people like Spain and SSEN are going to face when there's a huge amount of heat pumps. And I really, really want and welcome the idea of electrification of most of our heat and our mobility where we can, because it's by far the second resort, with with energy efficiency still being the first resort. But I think the challenge we're going to face with dealing with people on networks. I mean, Sven very kindly applied to Ofgem just this last year to get further provisions where we can use local trusted partners and community anchor organisations to actually help roll out things like heat pumps and the challenges we're going to have as people start to use these, the new technology and all the rest, and get people to adopt them and use them efficiently in the community. So those sort of things are all helping the interaction with the UK, where Scottish Government are both helping their individuals, their citizens, to decarbonise and have affordable and good lives, but at the same time making the national case. It'd be one I could think of straight off.
Thank you. And is that stimulating demand side of it? I think the Scottish Government have got a role. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, and I think from that point of view, I mean, yes, it's mostly about demand and making that case that I'll stick with that.
Thanks, Mark. And Maura, what's your ask of the Scottish Government to support network investment and readiness?
So one thing that my network colleagues' work will be based on is we have the future energy scenarios and similar systems, which is how the needs case is put forward for what's going to be needed in the future. And picking up on what Emily said earlier from Solar Energy Scotland, that setting of targets, so there's a clear signal of what is going to be done that feeds into those future energy scenarios, then allows my colleagues to put forward a case around that to Ofgem. So that is very helpful. Planning has come up at various points during this system, and I've said it in this Parliament before and I will say it again, the MPF4 is probably the best planning regime for renewables in the whole of Europe. It is to be commended, but it alone does not do the entire job. One of the key issues is there is no set format for how you put in a planning application, either for renewable energy development or for your grid infrastructure investment. So what tends to happen is the lawyers will be cautious, as lawyers are, and say, put in everything. Because the decision makers have no clear framework of what to ask for, they will get nervous and they will ask for more just to make sure that they've covered everything. And what we end up with is bigger and bigger and bigger, bigger piles of paper that then puts a huge strain on the whole of the system to try and deal with. And the fact that each application turns up looking entirely different from the one that went before means that you can't particularly build up expertise in where you look in this great big pile of paper for what you need to know. So we are in discussion with the Scottish Government at the moment to have a standardised format. We've been doing this stuff for 20 years. We have been doing grid infrastructure for longer than that. We should be clear on what it is that decision makers need to know to be able to make an effective decision. And we could do a lot of streamlining that way of cutting down those huge timelines. So again, that's a key thing that the Scottish Government can look at doing.
Thank you. Aileen and Scott, do you agree with that very briefly?
I do. And resources is critical in that. You know, there's a lot of people involved amongst a number of different authorities in the planning process and making sure that that is adequately resourced. And in particular, you know, you don't get that asymmetry of resource where maybe the applicant has got more resources and it overwhelms the parties that have to deal with that.
Convener.
Scott, did you want to say something very briefly or just say you agree? Or
I do agree. Planning, I've got to labour again, but the other piece, Aileen, and I can miss it, is that we have an opportunity for massive growth in the workforce right across the supply chain. That requires support and effort from Scottish Government into local colleges for the work in the low voltage, for new apprentices, all the way up to senior engineering roles. We have high quality jobs at every level. Also jobs that you wouldn't necessarily think about in these stuffy conventional networks businesses, data scientists, customer service professionals, and finance and commercial, of course, as well. There's a real potential for us here.
Okay, thanks for that. Liam.
Thanks, Convener. I'd just like to clarify something from earlier on, just specifically, I'll put this again to Scott and then Eileen after. Scott, you talked about regulatory frameworks. Now, my understanding is that Ofgem will set price controls, which regulates how much Scottish Power and SSE can spend on investment and innovation during a particular period. Now, I understand that both transmission and distribution are regulated until 2028, or they're in these regulated periods till 2028. So, Scott, first, what scope is there to alter your investment plans in response to changing circumstances, changing technologies, changing priorities during those regulated periods?
So we're now in the second year of our current transmission review, and there are two categories of expenditure that the regulator gives us. A baseline expenditure based on realistic forecast that we put forward. Some of that will be replacement and modernisation of an ageing asset base. Remember, a lot of this was built between the 60s and 90s and also needs to be replenished, modernised, brought up to modern standards, as well as the increased capacity to meet the load growth that we're talking about at the moment. But there are also significant uncertainty mechanisms that allow us to respond and apply to the regulator for further funding. So for schemes that are greater than £100 million, there is now the new ASTI framework. It was previously the large onshore transmission incentive mechanism, LOTI. As I said, there's an abundance of acronyms. So anything over £100 million, we had to submit the needs case. It was a fairly laborious initial needs case, final needs case, and ASTI changed the nature of that to make it much more agile on the part of the regulator. They will focus on support from the companies, the TOs and the plans that we submit, endorsed by the electricity system operator, and then work with us during the project assessment as we go to tender the contract to give us that award, to make sure that we're still efficient and we're doing all the right things. Below the £100 million, there are medium-sized mechanisms that we can access as well. There are probably a significant number of projects. I think at the moment, in January, I submitted 12 reopeners for MSIP projects to the regulator for them to process. And that was the point I was making earlier, is if our colleagues up at Scottish Hydro Electricity Transmission are doing the same, National Grid are doing the same down south, is the regulator equipped to actually process those quickly enough to give us a decision and let us get the investment out the door? But again, the regulator maintains... There is no sector, I think, is heavily scrutinised by a regulator. In our transmission business, every July we submit 1.5 million data points down to the lowest level of materiality. We publish our accounts in detail and the returns that we make to make sure that everything that we're doing when we're applying for these reopeners, ultimately the bill comes back to that level that the regulator was expecting it to for the consumer.
Very grateful. Aileen, would you like to add to that, or is it a similar situation?
It is the same, and the quantum of work that we're putting on the desk of the regulator is equally as large. I think we planned within this current five-year period to put forward 46 separate requests for funding, from right the way down to, you know, transmission is always really big numbers, but a couple of million pounds up to a couple of billion pounds, that's the scale of which you're looking at. The additional point, you referred to things changing as you go along, and there is a lot of change happening in our industry, in our economy, our society, you name it, within those fixed periods. And one of the things that we see when we engage with our stakeholders and our communities, they're particularly looking for us to take into account environmental, community and other impacts when we're preparing investment decisions, and I think that's right and appropriate. Ofgem is an economic regulator, and they've tended to underweight those broader considerations, and particularly tended to underweight the benefits of the economic development that can flow to a community and to economy as a consequence, an indirect benefit, if you like. And certainly one of the things we'll be looking for going forward, and this may be the questions around about Ofgem's duties, is to take into account broader factors than just those pure economic considerations when making investment decisions, but not doing it more slowly as a consequence.
I understand. Very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Liam. And Monica, you've got some questions. I'm going to cheekily say to you that till just after 12, and then I won't interrupt you, and then I will interrupt you.
That's okay. I mean, I think a lot of it's actually been addressed in the answers so far. I did want to focus on community energy. I thought Mark had frozen, but I saw some movement there. So we know that the Scottish Government aims to more than double community-owned energy and locally-owned energy to 2 gigawatts by 2030. You've already said what some of the key challenges are and talked about the current electricity network. So just wanted to come back to you. Is there anything else you want to add about the key challenges and in what way the sector is inhibited by the current electricity network? And then I was going to just ask a question, might just aim at you as well, Mark, around shared ownership, because government wants to encourage shared ownership models. Is that enough to just say encourage, or does there need to be a more formal mechanism to implement that?
Yeah, okay. On the first element of it is a lot of what I was saying earlier. I think when we had the feed-in tariff in play so 10 to 15 years ago, we were very, very much just hitting up on the challenges of infrastructure. But as that fell off and there's been a lull on that side, that's where there's been less of a challenge. But as we now have a situation where almost sadly that the wholesale price is going up again, these projects are starting to look economically viable again at a smaller scale, and we're going to face exactly the same infrastructure issues that we were facing a decade ago. And I do see a real important role, as you say. I mean, the two gig target from the Scottish Government is really welcomed. I think with good community taking on the responsibility, we could quite easily double that. I would feel, you know, there's an opportunity to an ambition and sites that would let us actually double that. But I think we will hit the grid issues, and a lot of it is actually the way it is set up. It's the securities, the liabilities that let smaller players get part of these larger the larger infrastructure reinforcements to be able to actually get a seat at the table and to be able to have a stake in it for a while, and quite often will express interest and will fall off as the price becomes too high, as the price becomes too high to continue to be part of those reinforcement strategies. So I think there is an element of de-risking, and I think that was what the Scottish Government did that well previously with the early stages with the CARES project and things like that, where they were able to provide support at risk early on, pre-permitting, that was then either paid back or becomes part of the socialised benefit once the projects are built out. So I think that's a big chunk of it. I think just encouraging shared ownership is well and good, and shared ownership is welcomed. I think with repowering and being sure with what we have offshore, we wouldn't want to turn down the opportunity of shared ownership, because I think community benefit is only, I feel, is the benefit you get from a proportionate involvement where the community actually takes responsibility and gets reward for that. So either whole ownership, proportional shared ownership, or owning the funds and making use of the funds is key. But we can't just encourage it. I think we've experienced over the last two decades is you have that risk of the sort of classic golden window boxes, that where people just don't know what to do with the money. And I think an important part, we had the opportunity with the forestry estate about a decade ago, and there was work even done by predecessor Fergus Ewing looking at how we can have better shared ownership opportunities. And a key thing is just enabling an organisation to be able to enter into discussions. You're taking basically non-technical people into a technical world. Am I not coming through okay? Yeah, okay.
Yeah, it's taking non-technical people. The convener caught my eye there. We're just about to
come. Oh, I'm talking.
No, that's okay, Mark. Just a final question, yeah. And you might not know a lot about this, but we've heard previously from North Ayrshire Council that they take a community wealth building approach, and we've heard about their work on solar. The Scottish Government's committed to bringing forward a community wealth building bill. Do you see that having an enabling role, or are there any opportunities within that for community energy and local energy?
I think absolutely. North Esh is probably a very good example for the point of view that even now they've set aside that fund of about 300,000 when they're looking to see how they can best use the point of view of enabling communities, and we've been in discussion with them, and that's exactly what I talk about. It's not just encouraging, you have to enable. It's setting people on the tracks so they can take advantage of the situation, and that's communities of small or even quite large scale. So it's that active and positive enablement more than just encouragement.
That's great. Thank you.
Yes. The Deputy Convener's got one follow-up question, then I have a question at the end.
This is a very short inquiry, and it's a massive area, but it's a chance to put the spotlight on our electricity infrastructure. Can I ask if there's anything that you wanted to tell us today that you haven't had the opportunity to, and then can I ask Maura, please?
Yes, I can start with that. So it's been touched on that Ofgem has a ambiguous relationship to the achievement of net zero. It is not in their primary legislation, and how that plays out. It was in the UK government's energy white paper that there would be the strategy and policy statement was due to be consulted on in 2021, and we've never seen hide nor hair. That is the mechanism by which the UK government can indicate to Ofgem the policies and strategies they need them to pay attention to. That is a mechanism by which you can get them involved in net zero without having to go back through Parliament to amend primary legislation. We would very much like to see that come forward, so any discussions that the Scottish Government is having with the UK Government around their achievement of net zero, it would be very helpful to raise that.
Aileen?
Sorry, I'm just going to limit you all because it could be an endless list. So if you could each give one, that would be brilliant.
You'd be pleased to hear I only had one. It's in relation to the setting of targets, which has been touched on a number of times today, and about the importance of targets being set in a joined-up way. You can set targets for technology in isolation, or for the number of jobs, or for economic benefit, or community, you know, or environmental impacts, and they can end up contradicting each other. So when targets are set, I think there's an important step around about going, well, actually, are they all mutually compatible? And from that perspective, and Morag talked about this earlier, when we're looking to do planning, having targets that are coherent, if you like, as a whole, gives a lot more confidence in that planning process, which then, of course, then feeds through into the development, to the planning consent, the delivery, and thereon. So,
is it? Okay, Scott, very briefly.
So I think that's the key theme here, is that I have often wondered how the regulator is compelled to adopt the targets that the Climate Change Committee or the Scottish Government have struggled with that, and that feeds into an earlier theme that both my colleagues made as well with respect to how is that then encapsulated in the evaluation framework when they come to make their decisions. If we can get that linkage formalised to a greater extent, I think it can help with the regulatory decision-making process.
And if we have time for Mark?
Yep.
Mark, anything you wanted to tell us?
Quickly, yeah. I think so. It'll be coming back on the recognition of the power and value of local content to community ownership. I think we've heard it from a planning regime point of view, but even in hard grid infrastructure sense, I think there's a lot of emphasis on the macro scale, but the opportunity where over half our power will need to be balanced at a local level, and the opportunity to make sure we're enabling that and doing that at low voltage and distribution. But to do that, we need to make a new system, the infrastructure smart, but also enable people to actually interact with that market.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to ask my one question at the end. So one of the books I read when I was younger, and I still look at, is a great book, Power from the Glens, which talks about Scotland's transition to using renewable energy in the form of hydro pump storage and all the rest of things, massive dam building. And as a result of that, we transferred power to the areas that need it along what were then superhighways. And Scotland's countryside had been shaped by that superhighways that were put in the 50s, the 132 kV lines. Do you think that, well, they were obviously built there for a reason because they were probably the best route and the most protected route. You've talked about planning, Aileen and Scott, and about the difficulties of it. Because those lines are already there, one way to avoid problems would be planning, would be to make sure that those lines are upgraded and form the basis of the superhighway in the future without moving them. Is that not a simple answer, Scott?
So I think, hopefully I picked up at the start that is an avenue that we will seek to exhaust all opportunities to uprate existing infrastructure, particularly for my business in the Central Belt of Scotland. We look to do that. So I highlighted earlier, for example, that we've got an export capacity from Scotland of 6.6 gigawatts. Over 2 gigawatts of that was delivered through not building any overhead line, but through innovations like series compensation, reducing the reactance and overhead lines, and uprating of some of the power corridors. But again, that, you know, the sort of Pareto optimality rule, that can only take you so far before you do get into building infrastructure. But those corridors will probably remain the most appropriate given the geology and location of them.
So, Aileen, you'll appreciate that from the Bewley to Denny line, which went from 132 kV to 400 kV, almost along exactly the same route. It seems to be sensible. And once it had been agreed that it's along the same route, planning became easier, didn't it?
Yep, January 2010, I remember it very, very well. And like you, you know, I look back on what happened in the 40s, the 50s, the 60s, and there's a lot for us to learn from that. And I particularly look back at the Hydro Act and the commitment within it around about bringing economic development to the north of Scotland and stopping depopulation after the war. And I think that runs through what we're trying to do here now as well. So, what you're saying is absolutely right. It's not the intention here to put up new lines and greenfield sites, much in the way that Morag described earlier in relation to the development of onshore wind. And if I give you a couple of examples, so you've referred to Bewley Denny, which was an uprate to a 400 kV. At the moment, one side of that is still operating at 275, and part of the network investment that we're making for 2030 will be to uprate that to 400. So there will not actually be overhead line investment in order to realise that greater capacity. Similarly, we're in the process of developing an overhead line reinforcement out to Skye, which will not only unlock decarbonisation, but also significantly improve the security of supply out, you know, on the island and out towards the Western Isles, and we're reusing the same route there as much as possible, and we will be taking down the old line once we've built the new one. So wherever we can do that and whenever we can use new technologies, then that is our first resort.
Absolutely. Okay, and you and I well know that I've been involved in the Skye project for constituents over there, and the problems have been faced, but it seems it's moving forward. Thank you very much, and thank you very much for the evidence you've given this morning. It's been extremely interesting. I am going to briefly suspend the meeting for 4 minutes, let's say, to allow the witnesses to move and so we can go on to the final item in public. So I briefly suspend the meeting till 12:11, please. Thank you.
Well, welcome back to this meeting. We're going to move on to agenda item 3, which is the consideration of a Type 1 consent notification sent by the Scottish Government relating to the proposed UK statutory instrument, the REACH Amendment Regulations 2023. This is a UK statutory instrument, and the UK Government is seeking the Scottish Government's consent to legislate in this area. The committee's role in relation to a Type 1 notifications is to decide whether it agrees with the Scottish Government's proposal to consent to the UK Government making regulations within devolved competence and in the manner that the UK Government has indicated to the Scottish Government. I'm going to ask if there's any comments members would like to make. I'll come to you first, Mark, if I may.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. And I think, as you noted, it is a Type 1 notification, so it does represent a significant change in the regulations. I noted that the regulations effectively delay both the registration and the compliance deadlines for a number of years. And in particular, I think for one category of chemicals, it delays compliance checks until 2035. So I think that has raised some quite significant concerns, particularly at the Westminster Environmental Audit Committee during their scrutiny of the regulations. And I think it's important that we hear from our Scottish Minister in relation to this, particularly about whether, you know, this does or does not represent divergence from the existing EU REACH chemicals. And I'd also like to understand a bit more about what the alternative transitional model is that is evolving for the development of our chemicals regulation in the UK, and how that has worked in relation to the common framework for chemicals and pesticides that our ministers are directly involved in with their counterparts across the UK. So I feel that there are some questions here for the minister, and it would be, I think, a great service to this committee if the minister could appear before us.
Okay. Deputy Convener.
I'm very conscious of the tight timescale for this, but I also want to emphasise the importance of regulation of chemical substances and the importance of the chemical industry actually to Scotland. So I think the importance of this area is key. I think it would be beneficial to hear from the Minister and perhaps also write, if we have time, to the relevant regulatory bodies in Scotland to get their perspective on this. It looks as if this is an essential step, but actually it is worthy of drilling down to the extent that we can do in the time that we have.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone else have any comments? On that basis, then, what I'm going to do is propose that we invite Murray McCallan to come to the meeting next week and give a short bit of evidence to explain the situation on this. And I'm also going to ask the clerks to write on behalf of the committee to the regulatory authorities to ask if there's any evidence that they would like to submit. Now, that evidence might be difficult to gather in the timescale, but I'll give them the deadline of Monday morning next week, so we've got time to consider it before the meeting on Tuesday. I think that's a logical way to deal with this, so we can fully understand it. So if everyone's agreed with that, that's what I'm going to progress to do.
Agreed.
Yeah, okay, so we're agreed on that. And thank you very much. Now, we have one more item, do we not, clerks, which is the consideration of agenda item 4, which is a negative instrument, the Water and Sewage Services to Dwellings Collection of Unmetered Charges by Local Authorities, Scotland Order 2023. This instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means that its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to annul them. No motions to annul have been made. Do any members have any comments on this? I have one question. I assume this is done each year. It would be useful to know if all the money that is levied is actually collected, and if there's a difference between the levy amount and what is actually passed to Scottish Water, I assume. So we could write to, if the committee were happy, just write for an information point to the minister to ask them for that information so we can understand what that is. But if there's no other comments, would the committee be happy to agree that it doesn't want to make any specific recommendations in relation to this instrument? So if we're agreed on that, that means that this part of the meeting is concluded and we're now going to go into private session.